Good morning. In this talk, I'm going to describe how we are developing mobile applications in order to teach physics and in order to help students to learn physics. And also, in the second part of the talk, I'm going to describe how the mobile sensors can be applied to do measurements and to help students learn physics anytime and anywhere. Well, mobile applications can be developed as a way to supply contents enriched with multimedia or simulations so that the students can learn anytime and anywhere. But as teachers, designers, and programmers, we have faced different problems. For example, what contents can we implement inside the applications? And about this, we decided to design each application considering only one concept, one simple content, so that the applications were light from the computational point of view, and also allowing the students to fully work with the application in short periods of time. The second decision we had to do is how could we deal with the different students' devices and different operating systems. The first decision was to choose Android for our application because the system that most students had in their devices. And for the second decision, how could we work with so many different devices from the screen sizes to computational capabilities? We decided to reach a compromise between how heavy, computationally speaking, the application was, how demanding it was, and how could we do it interesting for the students. So that was the second answer, reach a compromise. And about the cost, most of our students have data rate plans and can access the internet anytime. But if we want to expand or if we want to extend our applications to less favored students, to less favored environments, we must consider also students who cannot afford the continuous communication of their devices. So we are developing our application so that once download the application, the students can fully work with it, and if the application must connect to a server or to make a data transfer, it can wait till the Wi-Fi spot is available, to a free Wi-Fi speed. So here are the three answers we have decided, but there are two problems that we have not completely solved. That is how to include more communications within the applications in order to improve learning, communications between the students, and communications between the students and the teachers to improve their learning. Currently, we have only an asynchronous communication, either by electronic mail or by simple data transfer to a server where the teacher can follow the student's advances. But we are thinking on improving this communication for next developments. And the second point that we have not solved completely is how can we assess the student's work with our applications. In our applications now, we make this assessment measuring the time that the students employ, reading the theoretical contents, analyzing the results in the test, or analyzing also how they work and the results they obtain in the simulations. But if we want to include this assessment in the full student's grade, this probably must improve, and not to speak here, of course, of the important security issues that may arise here. Here I show you one example, 6 screenshots of one of the applications, the main menu with the different parts, some theory, a test, and here the simulation, the analysis of the simulation results, and the final assessment of the student. Here you see another example, similar structure, theory, examples, the test, and the simulation. And in this other slide, Here I only show the simulations of other three different applications that we have developed on solving AC and DC circuits. But the question is, where do we want to go with all these applications? Are we simply developing applications, or we want to go a little ahead? Well, our plan is to develop a framework of several applications, applications that can be developed by different authors and share them in a server, and the teachers can build different courses with these applications, so different students can follow different courses downloading different sets of applications, and they can also download other applications not belonging to the course they are following in order to build their own virtual learning environment. The server would include not only the application but also the databases holding the result of the students and all the data that is analyzed by the teacher. Well, this is about the application that we are developing, and the second part of the talk is about how mobile devices can also be used to make physical lessons. Well, in this scheme you can see several of the sensors that a modern mobile phone, smartphone, can have. For example, a gyroscope, accelerometer, sound or light sensor, barometer, etc. And many of these sensors can be used to measure physical quantities. So to help students learn physics, measuring those physical quantities. In many cases, data registered by these sensors can be accessed through free open applications, but most of these applications have an important problem, that is that the results cannot be contrasted against scientific measurement instruments. So we are also developing other applications. Here you have two screenshots of another application on acoustic measurements, and these applications that we are also developing can be calibrated against scientific instruments. You can see here, for example, the calibration of the results of two different phones, smartphones, again a sonometer, and once calibrated these devices with this application, they can be used, for example, in a teaching laboratory as a sonometer or as an analyzer of frequencies. But the important point is not only that the students can take their devices to a teaching laboratory and make measurements with them. The important point is that they can also use their devices to learn physics, experiment in physics, anytime and anywhere outside the teaching laboratories. So here you have three examples of measurements that can be done with this application. For example, they can measure interferences, the acoustic resonance in a tube, they can analyze Doppler effect, or, for example, they can just hold a ball, drop the ball, and just analyzing the sound of the bouncing ball, they can measure the gravity in the Earth's surface. So, where do we want to go, as I ended the first part of the talk, where do we want to go with these other applications? Well, the first aim of this second part of our work is to allow the students to learn physics, doing measurements by themselves, analyzing physical phenomena anytime and anywhere outside or inside the laboratories. The second important point is that this application, these devices so many sensors, can be also used in teaching laboratories. And so we can make so-called low-cost laboratories by changing scientific instruments in some cases, of course, by smartphones. We think that this is especially important, for example, for secondary schools that they have many students and low budgets, And so the use of smartphones in secondary schools can be a way to allow these schools to make physical or to have physical laboratories, physical teaching laboratories at lower cost. In fact, this year we are collaborating with two secondary schools in Valladolid and with students of scientific excellence baccalaureate in Valladolid and Segovia to show them how they can use these applications for their teaching and for their learning.